Well, here I am again. A couple of my buddies have been calling me and saying that I haven't done a video in a while. And I don't know, maybe, what was it? I guess we did it about a couple of weeks ago, a month ago, I don't know. But I've been working on stuff and I wanted to share this with you. One of the things I wanted to share is this. I was very glad to know that baseball coaches use physics quite a bit when they're talking about pitching and batting. Okay, I was like, wow, that's not bad. If those guys can do it, I mean, geez, they can do it, we can do it. But anyway, I put this thing together. I'm learning a little bit more about physics and what it is. Like I said, I never took physics. I'm not, you know, people call me a scientist. Sometimes I like to use words that maybe, you know, malapropisms or, you know, what have you. But, you know, I'm the Norm Crosby of physics. But anyway, I want to read this to you. Okay, I've been doing this. I have a long one, but this is a sort of a short one. Okay. Offensive linemen do work. Okay. Everybody says, yeah, well, big deal, Strollo. You know what you're talking about? No, work in physics is a measure of the distance that you move something. So when you move your guy any distance, you are doing work. Okay? I'm going to give you a couple more of these. And of course, these are in my words, just so I can understand them. Impulse is effort. Okay? It's not work. Okay? Impulse is like force, you know, force does work. Impulse is not work. Impulse is the time that you spent giving effort. But if you don't move the thing, you haven't done any work, okay? Power is the rate of work or the time it took you. Let's say I'm gonna move, and I get this vacuum cleaner here, and I move it across the room, okay? The vacuum cleaners are given thing, the distance is given. If it takes me this much time, I've made so much power. If it takes me half that time, I've made double the power. So power means the rate, okay? So when we say power cleans, the reason people like power cleans so much is because the bar is moving fast. And football is a speed game, okay? I want to say it's a power game, okay, and an acceleration game. Okay, but anyway, that's power. Acceleration is really what we do in football, if you ask me. Acceleration is any change in speed, either slower or faster, starting or stopping, and changing direction. Okay, acceleration is an important word. That's what we actually do, especially as linemen. Okay, again, a lineman does work by moving his guy over a distance. And if you think about it, he might be the only position on the field where work is his prime motive. You know, I say that the only position on the field, as a matter of fact, the only position in sport where the job of the position player is to protect another player is the offensive line. You think about it, all the sports in all the world, nobody else's only job is to protect another player except offensive linemen. Okay. Well, anyway, back to physics. That's enough philosophy for tonight. Okay, the amount of work. If work is measured in distance, okay, we say, or not we say, I just started saying this, but if you move your guy forwards, in other words, I'm taking a guy and I'm moving him, okay, I'm moving him in a positive direction, okay, force has direction. Okay, force has an origin, it has direction, it's going somewhere, it's in a straight line, unless another force acts on it, like gravity. So in the real world, there are no straight lines, but because of gravity. But anyway, when you move something where you want it to go and where you're going, that's positive. Anything against where you're going is negative. Okay, so I've been using this word resistance, and really, the floor has friction, resists your impulses. A big rock, the weight, the gravity of a rock. But a guy really doesn't make resistance. He makes force that resists another force. So what we say is, my opponent, is, if he's opposing me directly, he's making negative force to my positive force. In his mind, he's making positive force to my negative force. So if you move him, it's positive. If he moves you back, it's negative. If there is no movement, if it's a stalemate, there's no work. Okay? You didn't do your job. You're an offensive lineman. You work for a living. You do work for a living. You got stalemated. You didn't do your job. Okay? Okay, now, you know, I'm big into tools, okay, and levers. Levers are a lineman's tools. Okay, well, we've said this before, but all human movements are resultants of various levers that we call bones. Okay, this is just a straight third class or class three lever, you know, the fishing pole, the whip. Your legs are whips. When they run, they whip the ground. When you're running full speed, you're barely touching the ground. You're just hitting it. You're whipping it. You're actually flying through the air. You're hitting the ground intermittently. Okay. All levers make torque. So I'm torquing this, and if I want to push somebody, okay, I'm actually torquing this around. If I'm pulling something off the ground, I'm making torques. I'm making a bunch of torques and coordinating them, and for lack of a better term, you know, a physics term, I like resultant. In other words, a straight line force made by me is a result or resultant of many torques. Does that make sense? I think it makes sense to me. I don't care about you guys. I'm doing this for me anyway. Okay. The thing that we've recently discovered, probably in the last 2 years, is that you can use your opponent, not that we discovered it, but we named it in my own little way. You know, I mean, people knew it anyway. It just, I don't know, I've never heard anybody explain it this way. You can use your opponent as a lever. Okay, the tire flip, you can use him, you can flip him up. We call that lift. But remember, lifting means that you can't use him as a tool anymore. When you flip him, you're using him as a tool. Remember, levers magnify your force or your speed, okay? And when you get that guy off the ground, he ain't a lever anymore, he's just a big rock, okay? If I have this chair, okay, and I want to lift something, and I use this chair as a lever, as soon as I lift it off the ground, it's not a lever anymore, it's just something that's holding weight. Okay, so if I take this big giant thing that's filled with gold coins, it's actually a paint bucket, okay, and I can't lift it because it's too heavy, and I put it on my wheelbarrow and lift it very easily, I can move it and wheel it around, but as soon as I get the wheelbarrow off the ground, it's just a big collection of weight, okay? So I'm not using it as a tool anymore, I'm just using it maybe as a handhold. Okay, now here's a new word for you. I can't even say it, so I'm going to show it to you. Okay, hopefully you can see it. I don't know if you can. Let me see if it'll focus. Cremomorphism. Okay, and cremomorphism is really the exact, I'm supposed to be an English guy, but it's the exact opposite of personification. A personification is like, SpongeBob SquarePants, you know, it's some sponge, and I'm laughing just saying it. Sponge that acts like a person. Well, this cremorph, whatever it is, okay, is when a person acts like a thing. Like my deal is a big tree. A big tree, okay? There's a big tree, okay? I'm trying to emulate a big tree, but I'm a person. I can't be a big tree. I might be able to do certain things or have certain characteristics that a big tree has, but I'm not a big tree, I'm a person. I'm subject to all the things that persons do. I change shape, whatever, But when I make myself into that big tree, I can take on some of the characteristics of that tree, the positive characteristics of what we're looking for, okay? Now, you know, I'm big into this fundamentals. Well, the big tree gives us the fundamentals to do work. Okay, let me just take you through it again. I've taken you through it many times. You spread your feet, okay, just like you spread roots, okay? 2 feet, you only have 2 roots, so you're not that stable in a lot of ways, but you're pretty stable side to side, okay? You condense your body, which makes you a smaller lever. Nobody can use you as a tool, okay? We said that before. And also, that condensed body, okay, allows you to accelerate better, allows you to start better, stop better, and change direction better. When you're tall like this, and your center of gravity is further away from the ground, that is, it's a lever, okay? Make the lever short so you can change direction a lot quicker, a lot easier, okay? And, you know, guys will say, well, how low can you go? I don't know, that's better than, this is not so good, this is better, this is even better, this is even better. If you can't go much lower than that, that's all you can go. What do you want from me? It's not low man wins, it's condensed man accelerates, okay? Okay, and the third thing is to use your arms like long branches. I'm from Long Branch, New Jersey, by the way, to get to your opponent's body, okay? So we've used various things. We've used the hooks to grab people, okay? We've used the hammers, okay? Hooks grab, hammers punch and push. Mixed hands do both, give you a little bit of both. You know, you got a jab hand that holds the door open and a grab hand that you come along and grab the guy. Okay, just imagine this, you're trying to door slam shake, trying to hold it open. You don't have to move your feet as far if you play long. And then you can grab that, hold it open, grab it, and do what you want with it, go through the door. That's really what Scooty used, okay? But anyway, also the long arms protect your own body. And what we've recently discovered was it's a good way. The big tree is a very good way for hip and shoulder yokes, okay? It's the Tai Chi body hinge, okay? I use synchronized diagonal antagonists to create force, okay? That's the big tree, okay? Now, modifications of the big tree, because that's the fundamental position, that's the fundamental thing you're emulating, okay, when you're gonna do work, okay? Teetering is nothing but the big tree falling forwards, okay? You're in a big tree, you wanna be in the exact same foot position because you want your feet flat on the ground, you want your knees out, everybody says knees in, but when you put your knees in, your butt goes out, okay? So you want your knees out because you want to be in a singular plane with all your big joints. Okay, you don't want to be like this, going this way. And now if you want to make force this way, you want to teeter. Okay, and I'm going to just, hopefully this thing won't collapse. But this is me teetering, okay, without anything holding me up. I would teeter and fall on my face. This thing's holding me up. But when I go forward, okay, my momentum and the contact I make with my opponent holds me up, and if the opponent's gonna fight me, okay, and I'm teetered, I am buttressed against his driving force, and I can add various forces to that. Okay, so that is teetering. The brick wall, okay, we've recently just started calling this brick wall. I used to just call it stagger. Oh, this is a big tree, but staggered. Okay, so you're a little strong in the big tree, you're a little stronger side to side. In the brick wall, you're a little stronger front to back. Okay, it's hard to push you backwards because this leg is buttressed. It's hard to pull you forwards because this leg is posted and buttressed. Okay, you're a little more susceptible to side to side stuff, but you still have a bit of a base. Okay, the downside of the brick wall is simple. You know, you can't go over the up foot quite as easily as you can on a big tree. Now, one of the things about the brick wall, okay, you know, I've got it here, it's a solid foundation, but it allows you to tear, okay? I can tear people because I have a lifting leg, okay? I can tear people, I can elevate them up and throw them, become a hinge, okay? And I think it's easier to sling with a stagger. Okay, you can certainly sling from the big tree. I think slinging from the stagger is easier. Okay, now, if the teeter is the big tree in motion, the gallop is the brick wall in motion. Okay, and all the gallop is moving in the stagger. Okay, moving forward, moving backwards, and then pass blocking, not for nothing. It's just galloping backwards. Okay, shuffling is galloping sideways. So, and rewinding is galloping back. Okay, so think about it. What I'm trying to do is maintain that good post stagger that Coach McNally brought to us years ago from Jerry Wamford, okay, which is good in some instances, okay, it's bad in others, but when I gallop, if somebody hits me against my staggered or braced leg, I'm pretty strong. If somebody hits me this way, okay, I'm going backwards. Okay, so not to get into a bunch of technique, but that's gallop. Now, if you were going to draw a line of force on a piece of paper, it would be a straight line. Okay, and force is described as having magnitude and, what is it, magnitude and direction. Okay, so that's a force. And the power behind the force and the distance that it goes is the magnitude. Okay, an explosion goes in all directions. It has no defined directed direction. Okay, so a force is drawn as a line and it's called a vector. You don't have to know that, you just say a force line. Okay, when I'm in the big tree, my force line is up and down. Okay, when I squat, everything, all my big muscles, all my big joints are on the same force vector. When I teeter, everything's in the same force vector. Okay, now circular force is something that, you know, it's kind of like my little name for it. I guess what it really is angular momentum, angular velocity, angular, it's force in a circle. But think about this, okay? Just because it's force doesn't move in a circle unless another force is making it. I'm gonna give myself a baseball bat here, okay? It's kind of a short baseball bat. Let me give you a little bit longer baseball bat here. I've been doing a lot of painting. Yeah, it's a good baseball bat. Okay, a baseball bat travels in a arc, okay? Travels in an arc, okay? And if you hit the ball nice and square, okay, at the right time, the ball pops off that bat, okay? And assuming that you don't get any spin on it, if you hit it nice and concentric, it goes in a straight line. So this circular force is converted into a straight line. That's called tangent, okay? But when I go to punch somebody, my circular force is converted into a straight line. When I go to throw something, same thing. When I go to throw something, it's tangential, okay? The force goes straight. It goes in a tangent off of a circle. Here's the circle, it goes that way. It doesn't go this way. Now gravity pulls it. You know, 5 mile airplanes, I have them on a big long wire and they fly in a circle. If the wire cut, the airplane wouldn't continue to fly in a circle. It would go like, pow! Okay, we'll go straight out and fly away. We're actually going to crash because the wire would pull it down. But anyway, circular force is tangent to the motion. Okay, and that's important. Why is it important? I don't know. It's important to me. Okay, anyway, getting back to people. Okay, humans were built to run. You know, we say they're built to walk, but they're really built to run. Run, okay, and running is, again, it's force in a line. It's got direction, P Okay, it's got magnitude, depends on how fast you're running, how much power you're putting in. And football players run, right? They're runners. Linemen run too. But here's the question. Do they run when they're doing work? Okay? Remember, opponents accelerate. They'll dodge you, they'll change direction, they'll go at you. Opponents make force. And opponents' weight is also a consideration. A big, heavy opponent. Well, am I running when I hit this guy? I mean, I might run into him, but am I running to move him to do the work? Remember, no work gets done unless he gets moved. How do I move him? Do I run into him? Do I develop so much momentum in that half a step that I can get coming off the ball when he's attacking me that I can develop so much velocity, so much momentum that I just knock him backwards? Think about your board drills. Okay, it really doesn't happen that way. It's the guy that exposes his center of gravity. It's the guy that's weightless hands. That's where you go. Guys get twisted. Okay, all our twisting is, of course, torque. Okay. All right, well, I just want to ask you, I'm asking you questions more because I want you guys to think. Okay. I'm going to mention three sports. Which is most like blocking? Blocking, by blocking, I mean doing work. I don't mean getting in the way. I mean, which is most like what an offensive lineman does? A sprinter, okay? Remember, a sprinter is, his feet are off the ground most of the time. He gets up, you know, he accelerates, but then once he achieves that maximum velocity, he tries to maintain that with momentum. And he's using a lot less force, okay, a lot less impulse to keep going fast as he is to change direction, stop, or start, okay? So sprinting like playing offensive line? Sprinting like work? I don't know. How about weightlifting? Yeah, that's work. You know, I got a weight, I move it. Okay, but think about it. Weightlifting is primarily an acceleration. Like we're going to talk about power cleans. It's an acceleration, okay, from a standing start to a fairly high velocity with some momentum so you can catch the weight. Okay, but there's no change of direction other than the start from standing start, which is a change in inertia, okay? And if you think about it, there's certainly no acceleration, change of direction, stop, starting or stopping. There's pulling as high as you can, getting the bar to float and jumping under it, okay? Okay, the third question, or the third sport I'm gonna mention is sumo wrestling. Now think about sumo wrestling. There's a ring with two fat guys. They line up like they're playing football. They run into each other, and they very seldom run into each other and drive the other guy out of the ring. And that's the idea, is to get your opponent on the ground or out of the ring. Okay, but they clash, and that clash, sometimes they butt heads. It's positive and negative. If big Matsusuki is going this way, and big Yamasuki is coming this way, it's positive versus negative. Who wins? Well, that's the big question. Okay, but of those three sports, sprinting, weightlifting, and sumo wrestling, in my opinion, sumo wrestling is the most like blocking, is the most like doing work. I have to move my opponent out of the ring. I can throw him on the ground, he loses balance, he removes. I can dodge him, okay? I can accelerate out of the way and let him go running, so he can't be out of control either. I must use acceleration, and he must use acceleration to make contact, okay? If I'm running like this and he dodges me, I have to be able to change direction. I have to accelerate in that direction, okay? That's what we do, okay? Now, my question to you is this. We know we have to make contact, okay? Sometimes you can't avoid it, okay? But let me ask you this. Why run into a stone wall? Okay, now think about this. Let's say I've got a twin. Everybody's 300 pounds now in college football, pro football, who knows how big they are. They're all pretty good. They all get drafted every now. Okay, they're all fairly well, they're equals, okay? My positive force against my clone's negative force. If we're both equal and we both fire out, it's like me running into a stone wall, okay? It's not our combined It's not our combined force. In other words, if I'm making 100 pounds and my cone is making 100 pounds, it's not 200 pounds. It's 100 pounds, and it's a zero sum. I do no work. I make no gain, I make no losses, I do no work. It equals zero. His negative against my plus equals zero. Zero sum. That's cool. That's business stuff. Anyway, okay, now sometimes you just got to do that, but do we want to do that like as a game plan? I mean, we're going to knock them off the ball. Well, we knock State off the ball. Yeah, well, State wasn't that good. And, you know, this is like Notre Dame, and you ain't knocking them off the ball. Well, maybe you will. I don't know. Depends if you're Ohio State, you should do. Okay. Point being, if you have the talent, if you're more talented, but let's assume that we're going against equal talent, equal skill. Okay, equal ability more than equal skill. Right? So my question to you is, how do I win? Because I got to win. Okay, well, this is what I would say to you, and this is really the crux of it. Get an angle or make an angle. Okay, and this is really this has been my life's work, and this is what all these other videos are about. This thing right here is probably the essence of it. Okay, but think about this. Force at angles, okay? If I have two forces, okay, they both have direction, and they go like this, brick wall. Okay, but if I take one force going in this direction, and I stick it, I intersect it with another force, okay, it's not positive and negative force. Now, it's a resultant, it's a combination of the forces, but it's not positive versus negative. It's not a zero-sum equation. You're definitely going to make some movement. So what you want to try and do, if you can game plan, you know, we used to run a thing called Grace. It basically was block down, kick out. Okay, power play is block down, kick out. You know, that's the kind of stuff that you want to game plan if you can, okay, so that you can T-bone your opponent. Now, these 400 pounds, you still have to move them, okay, so you're still really not running. When you're moving and doing the actual work, I'll leave it up to you as to what's the best way to move him, okay? Okay, but to me, you're not fighting his force. You're only fighting the gravity, the weight, the mass, okay, and whatever friction, and if he reacts to you, okay? But you're not fighting negative force if you get an angle. In other words, I ear hole a guy or I T-bone, okay? I'm not fighting it. Now, one of the things that we do is learn how to make force in a direction that we're not facing. So if we're going to get T-boned by somebody, we want to, like the gallop is part of that, we want to, or rewind or chip, we want to learn how to make force without turning away from our area. Okay, in other words, if I have this area and I know somebody's going to hit me over here and I turn to meet them, I give up the area. Okay, so we want to learn how to do that, but you only have to, if you get an angle on a guy, you only have to deal with his acceleration, his change of direction, okay? If he smells it, if he sees the guard pull, the tackle block down, all of a sudden he's meeting the tackle's force. But if you're going to game plan something, you know, why not? And various double teams, block down, kick out, that's what I'm talking about, okay? And of course, zone for us is all of that. Okay. Now, you know, all the helps, the hammers, and things like that. Now, if you can't get an angle, make an angle. Now, here's the thing: when you're playing against a two-gap defender, okay. And to me, a two-gap defender is this: is either a guy that's lined up nose up on you and can play both sides of you, or two gaps. Or he's lined up in a gap, but he's attacking you. So he's going down your middle to play two gaps. He's a two-gap defender. Okay, you may not be able to, you know, we go against, the Dave Arandas of the world who's the new guy at Cal, you know, all these two-gap guys, the Pittsburgh Steelers are all two-gap, tight nose, tight shade, two-gap, okay. So how do we get an angle on this guy? Well, we don't really get an angle, we have to make an angle. Okay, one of the ways that we can make an angle okay, is this. I put this little chair in front of me. Okay, you can see it's kind of dark, right? Okay, he's two gap with me. If I go straight at him, no angle. Okay. If I turn my shoulders, he's got an angle. So what we do is we downshift, and look what we wind up with, a little bit of an angle. Okay, an angle, right? Now he might be able to close that angle off pretty quick, but all right, if you really think about it, the downshift brick wall, okay, I can either take the angle or I can just make the brick wall, it doesn't matter. And if I downshift and the guy comes with me, guess what? He's moving his feet, I've got the advantage. He's given up part of his origin, his resistance, even though I say we don't make resistance, but the ground resists our impulses. He's given up the resistance to his impulses, at least momentarily. I've made an angle, okay, by downshifting. Another thing that we do, okay, and this, I used to call this lifting, but we grab the guy, grab him and flip him. Well, when you grab somebody and flip them up, it's like you're flipping that tire. And because levers, okay, magnify your force, you can actually do this with your upper body and not much extension. So you stay condensed. Now the problem with the two-hand grab, okay, is it's short. You can see it's short. Okay. So what we did was we added a jab and grab. Okay, jab hand and grab hand. So we can, because the grab is, the mechanics of it are so superior that you don't really need two hands, and you can hold the door open if you have to get somewhere, grab them with this hand, and then add that other hand, and you're still grabbing them, and you're using him like a lever. You're using his feet like a fulcrum, his body like a lever to torque him. And the torque is not, everybody thinks torque is twist. This is torque, that's a torque, okay? That's a torque. I am torquing this thing. This thing is traveling in a circle on the fulcrum, okay? If I can get that, now we know that torque is best. The lever arm is most efficient when the torque goes into the lever arm at 90 degrees. In other words, if this is my fulcrum and this is my force, if my force is at an angle, it shortens the effect of this lever arm. This is the lever arm, okay? But if I can keep it at 90 degrees, or guess what it is? Tangent to the circle, okay? It magnifies my force tremendously, okay? Very, very interesting tool, the lever, okay? We can, all right, we talked about downshifting. We can grab them and flip them up, okay? We can tear them by flipping them in the armpit, tear him and drag him, okay? And it's much easier to drag a guy than it is to push him, because when you're dragging him off of his feet rather than onto his feet, okay? We can just throw him, okay? If he's not giving us a lot of inertia, a lot of force against us, a lot of negative force, okay? And he's really kind of neutral, okay? We can throw him. Okay, we can just boom, you know, it's the same, it's just a boxer hook, get him under the armpit and throw him, okay? We can jab him off center. Now, I don't have my illustration here, but if a guy's coming at me and I put him right down the middle and he's really coming at me, maybe I can stop him, maybe I'm not strong, I don't know, but if I get him off center, if I get that shoulder turned, okay, and I do it again by, okay, right, pull and push, and I can get that shoulder turned a little bit. Guess what I've done? I've created an angle. I've exposed his ribs. I get his shoulder turned, and I get a chance to get him with the other hand in the ribs. Okay. Of course, we can hammer people. In other words, I got this guy grabbed, and somebody comes over and hits him at an angle. Now all of a sudden, that hammer guy has defined him for me. And guess what I'm doing? I'm swinging them, right? And then I'm just driving them, I'm going, right? In other words, I got this dude, he's killing me, you know, we're in zero-sum equation, we're in a stalemate, and somebody over here just comes over and says, bam, okay? and defines them for me, gets them moving, I'm in great shape, okay? And the along the same lines is, you know, the brick wall, the sling, the hay bale sling, okay, which is really pretty nice, you know, really pretty physical. Hammer and hay bale sling are almost identical, but the hammer, you don't know you're getting the help, the hay bale, you made a call. Okay, so when you're hammering, you're just hoping for the best, okay? You know, you've got this guy grabbed, you think you're gonna get help, but you don't really know. Or the hay bale is like, hey, what do you think, can we do it? And so now you've got him with a jab hand and a grab hand, and you're gonna dump him like he's a trash can, because your guy's gonna come over there and knock the piss out of him, knock him right down the middle, because you're fighting his negative force. This guy ain't fighting it. This guy that's helping, he ain't fighting nothing but that guy's mess. And you got part of that mess already handled by your force. And when you're in the brick wall, you're making force. I say resistance, you're making force. You're making force, okay? Resistance. I got two regrets in my career. One is bringing my work home with me and having my wife and kids listen to me complain, and the other is naming stuff too quickly. Okay, because you gotta go back and erase it and all this other stuff. But I kind of like this right now. It makes a lot of sense to me. Okay, just remember, linemen, offensive linemen, probably the only sport other than sumo, you move your guy in a direction away from where he wants to go and towards where you want him to go. That is work. No movement, no work. How do you get movement? Well, best is to get an angle so you don't fight his negative force. And if you can't get an angle, make one. That's all I got.